this time fucking go to sleep. Now, in case you think you're bad, here's Jack. God knows what you need.
This time he couldn't fight the scream. He had to let it go. He opened his mouth and wailed in terror. The air in his lungs crushed his chest against the floor and his back against the roof. He couldn't tell if his eyes were open or shut. He pushed forward with his feet and regained the inch he moved back. He stretched with his arms, felt up ahead again. His shoulders were jammed so tight he couldn't move his hands through much.
before he started thinking straight. So he ran back and ducked into the motor pool once more. Found what he wanted. He found it on one of the Jeep's top hook assemblies. Some heavy stiff wire, ready to feed a trailer's electric circuits. He wrenched it out and stripped the insulation with his teeth. Ran back to the moonlight. He kept close to the road, all the way back to York. 2 miles, 20 minutes at a slow agonizing jog through the trees. He looked around behind the ruined northeastern block and approached the courthouse from the rear. Anything else is traceable. He swayed and leaned on a tree. Gave the spread, everything, beginning to end. She said, ground to air missiles. Mass suicide. A nightmare. Not our nightmare, he said. We're out of here. We should stay and help you, she said. The families. He shook his head. Best help is for us to get out. Dial the Chicago fax number on the fed sheet into the machine. And word obediently and pulled the paper through. Set it back out into her waiting room. Hit the button for the confirmation. Didn't want to leave any trace behind. Another sheet fed out. It showed the destination number correct. Time message at 10 minutes to 5 Friday morning, the 4th of July. She shredded both papers small and buried the pieces in the bottom of the trash can. Reacher rooted around on the long counter and found the paper clip. Followed Holly back out into the moonlight and relocked the door. Dodged around and found the cable leading down from the shortwave wind into the side of the hut. Took the paper clip and worried at it until it broke. Forced the broken end through the cable like a pin. Pushed it through until it was even, a fraction showing at each side. The metal would short-circuit the antenna by connecting the wire inside to the foil screen. The signal would come down out of the ether, down the wire, leak into the foil, and on the way to ground without ever reaching the shortwave unit itself. The best way to disable a radio, smash one up and gets repaired. This way, the fault is untraceable. Until an exhausted technician finally thinks to check. We need weapons, Holly whispered to him. He nodded. They crept together to the armory door. He looked at the lock. He shut up. It was a huge thing, unpickable. I'll take the block from the guy guarding me, he whispered. She nodded. They ducked back into the trees and walked through to the next clearing. Reacher tried to think of a story to explain his appearance to Joseph Ray. Figured he might say something about being beamed over to the UN. Talk about how high-speed beaming can rip you up a little. They crept around behind the punishment hut and listened. All quiet. They skirted the corner and Reacher pulled the door. Walked straight into a 9mm. This time, it wasn't a Glock. It was a Sig Sauer. Borkins. He was standing just inside the door, with little Stevie at his side, grinning. Chapter 37. 4:30 in the morning, Webster was more than ready for the watch change. Johnson and Garber and the General's aide were dozing in their chairs. McGraw was outside with the telephone linemen. They were just finishing up. The job had taken much longer than they had anticipated. Some kind of interface problem. They had physically cut the phone line coming out of York and bent the stiff copper down to a temporary terminal box they had placed at the base of the pole. Then they had spooled cable from the terminal box down the road to the mobile command vehicle, connected it into one of the communications ports. But it didn't work. Not right away. The linemen had fussed with multimeters and muttered about impedances and capacitances. They had worked for 3 solid hours. They were ready to blame the army truck for the incompatibility. When they thought to go back and check their own temporary terminal box, the fault lay there. A failed component. They wired in a spare, and the whole circuit worked perfectly. 4:35 in the morning. McGraw was shaking their hands and swearing them to silence when Webster came out of the trailer. The two men stood and watched them drive away. The noise of their truck died around the curve. Webster and McGraw stayed standing in the bright moonlight. They stood there for 5 minutes while McGraw smoked. They didn't speak, just gazed north into the distance and wondered. Webster said,
Mm-hmm.
Weighs more than 10 tons empty, and it can lift another 11. It's a giant flying box, the engines and the fuel tanks strapped to the top and the sides, the crew perched high in the front. Any helicopter can search, but when heavy equipment is at stake, only a Chinook can rescue. Because of the holiday weekend, the Peterson dispatcher assigned a skeleton crew of two. No separate spotter. Could it be to find five army trucks on some shoulder in Montana?
You should have stayed here,
Borkin said.
Mm-hmm.
Reacher glanced into the gloom inside the punishment.
right, Joe?
Morgan said again. Ray made no reply. Morgan walked over and grabbed his fist into his face. Ray stumbled and fell back, staggered against the back wall, and scrambled to regain his position on the square.
I asked you a question,
Morgan said. Ray nodded. The blood poured off his chin. Reacher should have stayed here, he said. Morgan hit him again. A hard straight right to the face. Ray's head snapped back. Portland.